Now that we learned what the main parameters for a neural network is, let's take a look at where we can change them, where we can set them in the code itself. So I just got the example code that we used in the exercise previously. As you've seen there are basically three steps for us to start training our network. The first one is setting up the network, setting up the layers. Here we're doing it a little bit differently. In the example or in the exercise, we were doing it by adding one by one. That's also possible. That's a feasible or totally acceptable way of doing it. Another way to do it is basically pass all the layers to your Keras model sequential function as a list, basically. And here that's what we're doing. It's kind of easier to read, not a lot of redundant text. That's why I use it here this way. So let's go one by one and see where our hyperparameters can be set. But as I said, so we have three steps. Basically, the first one is to create the model, create the architecture of the network, and then we compile with some additional information that we're giving to our network. I'll show you in two different ways how we can do that, and the fitting the data to the model or to the network. So these are the three steps. So let's start with the first one. We know the first thing, one of the first things that we need is the batch size, right? And the batch size you set while you're trying to fit your data to the network. So we set it here using the model fit function. We can specify the batch size. The next thing we can look into is some of the things that are basically determined by the problem, right? So the first one is the amount of neurons in the input layers. As we said in the lesson, this is going to depend on how many features your data has or how many pixels, for example, in an image. So this is predetermined. We do that in the first layer, basically here. In our example, we had a 28 to 28 image. That's why we gave it as, input shape is 28 to 28, flatten it. But if that wasn't the case, if we only had sequential data, then we would only create here however many neurons we would need for the input layer. Same for the output layer. This is going to be predetermined by our problem. So what we're going to do is we're just going to create a dense layer at the end, and we're going to specify how many neurons there should be in this little section here. Another thing is number of hidden layers. A number of hidden layers is basically here too. I will explain the dropout in a second. And you can, as we talked about, this is kind of experimental, and you can put as many hidden layers as you like. And you do that, you determine that by basically creating a new layer every time. And for the number of neurons in these layers, you are going to specify them here. So when you create a new layer, a new dense layer, the first parameter that you pass to it is the number of neurons that should be in that layer. Another thing that we talked about is the activation function. So activation functions are determined per layer, so it only makes sense, right, to do that while you're creating the architecture. We do that in every layer, as I said. The input layer does not need an activation function, but every other layer does need it. If you do not give some of the information that I'm giving here, for example, the activation function is going to default to the default value that they have in the Keras library. Here, as I said, then you write the activation function that you want. And if you want to know what your options are, I will put this also in the course code base, so you can download this notebook and see for yourselves. But it's very easy if you want to see how many activation functions or what are the options for activation functions. Just Google Keras activation functions or use this link to go here, and then you are able to see all the available activations and how they can be used and some explanations and information about them too. The next one that we can talk about is the kernel initialization. So we said we are going to update or initialize our weights and biases. Biases are normally initialized to zero, so there's not much we might want to do there. But if you want to initialize your weights in different ways, this is how you specify it. So this is not a random choice. we will decide on the initialization technique in a very conscious way. And this is going to be the topic of the coming lessons. So in these lessons, we will know specifically how or which initialization technique to choose and when. But just to show you how we would do that, it's basically like this. You just specify the kernel initializer. Regularization, on the other hand, again, can be done per layer. You can just add a regularizer. It's called kernel regularizer, and you can use L1, L2, or L1 and L2. There are certain options. Again, if you're curious about them, you can use the regularizers here, a list of regularizers here. There are also options to do bias regularization, for example, but we are going to look into kernel regularization only. Another way to do it is basically, this is going to depend on the technique that you're using. Again, we're going to learn more about regularization techniques and when to use them in the coming lessons. But just to show you, so this is one way of using regularization, and a second way is to add a regularization layer. And you can see the options for regularization layers again here. As I said, you can easily Google and find these or use these links to find them. What else do we have? So we have number of epochs, right? So this is number of times that the whole data set is run through the network. And logically, we do that while we're fitting the data. We specify that number while we're fitting the data. So this is how you specify the epochs. Something else, we can change the optimizers in our network. So what we said in the building blocks of deep learning lesson, we learned, the network learns by doing backpropagation and gradient descent, right? Gradient descent is the optimization algorithm. But there are other ways how you can do optimization. So there are, let's say, more efficient ways, in a way, how you can do optimization on your network. And while you're doing that, you can basically, if you choose to use a different way, the default is the gradient descent, but you can use other techniques too. I see that I wrote it two times, so I can remove this one. So yeah, while you're compiling your network, you just specify the optimizer to be gradient descent. So this is one way. The problem is, optimizers themselves have some parameters. So this could be, for example, like we see here, learning rate. So if you don't want to use the default values for the parameters of the optimizer itself, then you can do it like we see in the second line here. So at first, you create an optimizer, and we are going to choose that basically, or create that based on the documentation here. As you can see, you can see your options here and how to create them if you want to. You basically create and put it in a variable, and you can specify all of the parameters that you want that to have, and then you compile your model, and as the optimizer, you just pass this variable. So that's a very simple way to do that. Adds a little bit more of a complexity, but that is if you don't want to use the default values. And that brings me to the learning rate. Learning rate is another thing that we need to specify for our model, and you specify the learning rate through the optimizer. So you do not specify it directly to the compile method, but you do that inside the optimizer. So if you want to use something different than the default value of the learning rate for the optimizer of your choice, you need to opt for the second option where you specify the learning rate to whatever you want it to be. There are ways to keep the learning rate dynamic, so it can change during the training, but we will learn more about that in the lesson where we talk about learning rate, so we don't have to go into that here yet. Yes, and it looks like the last thing that we have, the last hyperparameter that you can change, is the loss, or how the loss is calculated. I guess we can call it loss function. This is again going to depend on your problem, on the project that you're working on, and what you're trying to optimize. There are a lot of options for those. You can go and find all of the possibilities here. They also have really nice explanations of when to use which one. So for example, if you click this one, it helps you choose basically by giving you some description. It says use this cross-entropy loss function when there are two or more labels etc., etc. So this is going to highly depend on the problem that you're trying to solve and how you set it is in the model compile function. You pass it, pass this value to it, the string value to it, and the loss parameter of the compile function. So this is generally how you can set up your network. As I said, if you want to see options of what can you set, what regularization technique can you use, what activation function can you use, just go to the Keras documentation. But as I said, basically there are three types of hyperparameters we're going to face. One of them is like the input number of neurons in the input layer, or number of hidden, or the number of inputs on the output layer. These are going to be predetermined based on your data, so you cannot change them much. They're going to be predetermined. There is going to be parameters, hyperparameters, like number of hidden layers, number of neurons in the hidden layer, or batch size, or epochs, for example. This is going to depend on, this is basically not going to depend on anything solid. We're just going to have to experiment and find the best option. And we're going to have to tune them in time and find whatever works the best for us. Then we have another category of hyperparameters, which is kind of like the optimizer or the kernel initializer. And that's going to, again, we're going to need to tune those hyperparameters. But at the same time, we're going to need to kind of follow some rules and follow some of the best practices that are out there to choose them. Because you might need to choose the correct activation function and initializer, weight initializer, in combination to be able to perform optimally. So, you know, they're kind of tried and tested and proven ways of using them and in which cases to use them. So these three types of hyperparameters are going to be the things that we'll be dealing with. As I said, for many of them, we will go into more details of the options that we have here that we can choose, and also when and how to use them in the coming lessons. So hope this was all clear. Again, if you have any questions, don't hesitate to comment under this lesson, and see you in the next lesson.